features a suite of poems looking at the submerged spiritual practice in St. Lucia and throughout the Caribbean called the Obia.
So, and finally, so unfortunately only via Skype, as for personal reasons he could not reach us today in Berlin, but we are very honored to introduce Achille Mbembe, the philosopher and political scientist. He doesn't actually need much presentations, but we want to stress the fact that since his early publications, and especially since the publication of On the Post-Colony, for savvy contemporaries, Mbembe has represented a main reference and a sort of lighthouse, especially for his very intelligent and sharp critique, not of the West per se, but of the effects of cruelty and blindness produced by a certain colonial conception of reason, and also of humanism and of universalism. His analysis of the power of the archive and its limits has, for example, inspired us for our archive project, Colonial Neighbors, on German colonial history, and also his reflections on the necropolitics has been crucial for us many times. So in his writing, Mbembe argues that the academic and popular discourse on Africa is caught within a variety of clichés that are completely tied to Western fantasies and to Western fears. He says, Africa is the mediation that enables the West to accede in its own subconscious and give a public account of its subjectivity. So these words are very much working in the context of what we are trying to do, of our analysis of witchery and our intention to liberate it from the savage lot to which it has been confined by Western science and culture, and to free especially African tradition from this caricature of third worldism to which it has been too often subjugated. Two biographical notes. Achille Mbembe is research professor in politics at the University of Witwatersrand, Institute for Social and Economic Research. Mbembe is the author of many seminal books, among which the above quoted On the Postcolony, Critique de la Raison Nègre, and many other articles, essays, and publications. He's also contributing editor of the scholarly journal Public Culture, and his annual visiting appointment at the Franklin Humanities Institute at Duke University. So, welcome Achille Mbembe, and that the spirits and the gods will be with us for this Skype connection. Hoping it's going to work for 20 minutes.
It's a bit funny to be talking to you, but not to be able to see any one of you. So I will just imagine you in my mind and try to make the best of that imagination. I'm very sorry to not have made it to Berlin. I was looking forward to do so and to learn from the encounters, exhibitions, discussions. I would like to thank Lynn Bonaventure and everybody in the room. I know some friends are in, Nora, Nikolai, and many others. I would like to acknowledge them. What I will do in the next 15 to 20 minutes is to share with you a few remarks on the question of African futures and the futures of knowledge or knowledges of the future. First of all, I would like to make it clear that if there is a future project we have to hang on to in Africa, a future project we have to strive for, this project can be summarized in a few words. Africa must become its own center. This is, in fact, a rather old aspiration. It's not new at all. The history of this aspiration is too long to be dealt with in 20 minutes. Let me just say that it's an aspiration that first emerged in the diaspora, in the context of plantation slavery in the Americas, in the Caribbean. It is an aspiration that underpinned most of the struggles led by people of African descent or Africans themselves, save at least from the late 18th centuries on. It's an aspiration that underpinned, for instance, the struggle against colonialism, the wars of decolonization, the struggle against apartheid. The aim of all those struggles was to make Africa its own center. And when I say to make Africa its own center, I mean to make of it political, economic, and cultural power capable, because of precisely that power, to contribute to the well-being of humanity in general. This aspiration to make of the continent its own center was also underpinned by the dream for African people and people of African descent to live in a world free of racism. Since, in any case, slavery, colonialism, and apartheid were forms of institutionalized racism. So the dream to live free from racism was part of that aspiration. The fact is that as we enter the 21st century, it has become clear enough that not one single person of African descent, wherever he or she lives, will enjoy the full dignity of afforded to human beings as long as Africa is on its knees. Whether they like it or not, their fate in whatever part of the world they live is deeply connected to the fate of the African continent. So we can talk about that, but it seems to me that this remains the kernel of Africa's reflections on its own future. So that's the first thing I wanted to share. And let me add that it is not only in the interest of the continent itself, but it is in the interest of the whole of humanity that Africa becomes its own center. Now, a second set of remarks I would like to share. For Africa to become its own center, it seems to me that the continent must turn itself into a vast space of circulation. For the time being, we suffer from a double penalization. On the one hand, we have witnessed almost all over the world the return of wars, the return, the militarization of frontiers and boundaries, all of that in the name of security. We are well aware of what is going on, for instance, on the southern frontier of Europe in the Mediterranean. The fact that the Mediterranean has become somewhat of a vast cemetery, if one is to consider the number of people who die almost every week, every month, trying to cross these vast liquid expanse in the hope of reaching the shores of Europe. So we are penalized in the sense that overall, Africans are not welcomed. They are hardly welcomed anywhere in the world today. We are penalized, secondly, in the sense that Africans are not welcomed in their own continent. After all, the continent is composed of more than 53 states, each with, on average, three or four boundaries, which, when multiplied by the number of states, produces hundreds of boundaries internal to the continent. So we cannot move outside and we cannot move inside, which are called double penalization. So it is very clear that for Africa to become its own center, we have to undo systematically the hundreds of boundaries, most of which are the result of colonialism, which make it very difficult today to harness the resources of mobility, of circulation, that have historically constituted capital resources in the way in which we have produced our own history in a self-determined manner. So I put forward there this question of boundaries and frontiers, not only really as an African question, but as a global planetary question. To some extent, the big struggle of the 21st century will be the struggle opposing those who basically can go anywhere in the world and those who can hardly move. So this question of the government of mobility will be a major question of the 20th century, 21st century, in relation, of course, with the kind of global ecological crisis we are facing. So it seems to me that for any discussion on African futures to make sense at all, it has to deal clearly, consciously, methodically Yes. Okay. See now. I hope it's not witchcraft. I never know. I must have been seeing something really horrible. I hope not. I was saying that as Europe is, or at least seems to, be closing its doors, in fact, we should be opening ours. We should be preparing the continent to become a major destination for a new cycle of immigration. Already, there's no major African metropolis today that doesn't have, for instance, its Chinese neighborhood. If you ask me, I would say this is something that is good, provided, of course, certain conditions are met. We have to move in the direction of further transnationalization of the continent, which implies, as I was saying a second ago, the opening of our doors to new cycles of immigration, the opening of the continent's doors to the possibility for those people of African descent who want to tie their fate with that of the continent to enjoy one or the other forms of African nationalities or citizenship, the right of return if you want. So it seems to me that these are some key questions that cannot be left behind if we are serious about posing the question of Africa's futures in this new century. Of course, all of that goes with new ways of dealing with the immense resources that our continent has, moving from an economy of extraction to a different kind of economy in which the raw materials that we own help to foster some form or the other of industrialization. It means, for instance, major investments in social basic compacts, education, for that matter, healthcare, major infrastructure, investments in ecologically friendly energy production operations. I won't go into those details, but we can address some of them during the discussion if you want. Let me now make a few comments on the question of knowledge as such, or knowledge production. And here, it seems to me, a few clarifications are important to be made. First of all, especially in this age of ours, I think that it is important to make a distinction between knowledge and opinion. Opinion is not knowledge, especially non-informed opinion. Knowledge has to do, or let's say is the result of a conscious, methodical, disciplined effort to push back the frontiers of ignorance. And this is what makes it different from an opinion. Knowledge has to do with a major struggle against ignorance. And God knows, in this age of ours, there's still a lot that we do not know. But there's also a lot that we know. And in fact, the paradox of our times is that the more we know, the more ignorant we become. And it seems to me that unless we unlock that paradox. The possibilities of building a world of understanding, a world beyond differences, those possibilities will be crippled. How is it that we have never known as much as we know about the world today, and yet our forms of reasoning, our ways of relating to each other, have become dramatically simplistic? Second clarification, I think that knowledge is different from lived experience. We cannot conflate those two domains. Of course, we can use lived experience. We can think critically about it, reflexively about lived experience, and draw from lived experience a whole set of things we didn't know prior to having undergone that trial, so to say. But there's a clear distinction to be made, especially nowadays, between lived experience and knowledge. Knowledge requires reflexivity, it requires a pedagogy, it requires methodology, it requires the cultivation of a specific faculty, since we are in Berlin and in Germany. A German philosopher wrote explicitly about, Kant, the faculty of critique. There's no knowledge without some capacity to critique, a capacity that is learned, that is a skill, that is acquired through a set of disciplines we agree to subject ourselves to. And God knows democracy today needs that faculty of critique. It needs it because part of the work, what we call neoliberalism, this moment when basically a huge part of the economy consists in buying debts and selling debts and creaming of the profit that comes from those operations. In this age of neoliberalism, part of what the dominant system does is to cripple our faculty for critique. And therefore, if we want to harness the resources that would allow us to reimagine the world anew, we need to systematically cultivate that specific faculty that was at the kernel of what Kant called the Enlightenment, by which I mean, therefore, that we need to give a second chance to enlightenment, to the Enlightenment, at a time when the economic system, the global security regime under which we all live, all of this seems to conspire to cripple that faculty, both in the global north and, of course, in the global south. A fourth point I would like to put on the table, especially as far as Africa and Africa's futures are concerned, is this idea of knowledge banks. Like you go to the bank, a big structure where capital is deposited. The idea of knowledge banks, or if you want, the deep archives of knowledge, which we find in every human society. It's not true that these deep archives are the property of some quote-unquote civilizations or cultures and are absent in others. That's clearly not the case. What is going on, as far as Africa is concerned, is that on the one hand, a lot of that deep archive has been destroyed. And a lot of the knowledge we have produced over history, a long history, that didn't start yesterday, didn't start with colonialism. It started long ago, well before the slave trade, for instance. We have lost a lot of that archive. But a lot of it still remains. And the task for today, for tomorrow, and for the future is to tap into that archive. I mean this for all the disciplines of modern disciplines of knowledge, but also for artists. We haven't, I would suggest, we haven't used 3 or 4%, for instance, of our artistic archive, of our archive of forms. We need to rediscover that deep archive and harness it. How? Through a whole set of means we unfortunately don't have the time to go through in the next 5 minutes that remain, but let me just put it out there as a principle, the absolute necessity to rediscover those deep archives of knowledge, those banks of knowledge, some of which has been destroyed, lost, irremediably lost, but a lot of which remains, a lot of which can speak to the challenges of today. The second thing, still in relation to this concept of knowledge banks and deep archives, the second thing has to do with the fact that a lot of what people know in Africa is not written down. It is lived, it is experienced, but it is not written. You cannot go and find a book and read it. There's no dictionary, there's no book. It is performed, it is embodied in people's bodies, people's minds, but also rituals. And therefore, that social knowledge that is not written is clearly a set of raw material we also can tap into. We will not be able to achieve what is called today decolonized knowledge if indeed we do not take seriously that question of the deep archive. Let me move towards the end by putting on the table two things. First of all, if we are serious about the question of Africa's futures, we will have to remind ourselves of the fact that there is no future without what anthropologist Arjuna Padurai calls the capacity to aspire. Part of what colonialism, racial domination, or oppression does is to damage people, especially poor people's capacity to aspire. How we reconstitute those capacities of projecting oneself towards what is not yet there, towards what can be, becomes therefore a major political challenge to the kinds of knowledges we produce and disseminate. When I say we, I do not simply mean academics, I mean all those who are invested, artists including, in pushing backwards the kingdom of ignorance. It seems to me that we cannot fight against ignorance without at the same time rekindling somewhat this capacity to aspire. Finally, I think that the future of Africa is closely linked to the future of the world. We cannot separate the future of Africa from the future of the world. I would go as far as to suggest that, in fact, the future of our planet is being played out in the African continent. So what I want to suggest, the new hypothesis from which we have to begin to reconsider our relationship with the continent, our reflection of the continent, is the following. To a large extent, the future of the world is being played out in the African continent. So this planetary turn of the African continent, I think this is the major event of the 21st century. It entails a whole set of political struggles and new engagements, the first having to do, as I intimated when I started sharing these remarks with you, a revisiting of the whole concept of boundaries and frontiers. We have to open our frontiers, our boundaries, if we are to give a new chance to democracy, meaning to the whole idea of an open society. We have to deepen democracy itself, and I would say in three directions. One, in the direction of the idea of the common, as opposed to the idea of difference. In the direction of the idea of a world that is limited, that is not unlimited, a world that we have to share with other living species, human beings, non-humans, organic, geomorphological, climatological entities. And we have to deepen democracy in a direction that makes it possible for democracy to make a space not only for those who look like us, but also for those who do not look like us, for the foreigner. If we manage to do all of that, then it seems to me that we'll give a chance to the continent. And giving a chance to the continent will give a chance to the world at large and to humanity in general. So those are a few thoughts I wanted to share. Once again, I'm very sorry it won't be there, but I'm sure that with Bonaventure and the end, you must be having a lot of fun. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for finding the time. We are very happy that we could use this kind of Skype witchery to get you in. So thanks for this brilliant, push, these thoughts that go very much in line with what we do think at Savvy. And we would like to call out for a few questions. But before I get to the first and the second and the third question in the audience, we have to limit it because we have a keynote lecture by Jean-Pierre Bekolo after this. I wanted to comment on something. And this idea of the knowledge bank, this idea of the bag we have to fetch in, you know, is something we find quite important, you know, exploring, you know, embodiment practices, exploring ritual practices, I mean, at Savvy. I wanted to make a shift. What about some of these objects that were taken away from the African continent and that lie in the museums all around the world that also kind of embody some of these knowledge systems that you said we've lost? How do we go about them?
Okay, the communication is a bit funny, so I might not have heard everything you said. But let me just add one or two comments to a very important question you raised, which has to do, on the one hand, with this concept of knowledge banks, and they go together, the idea of a deep archive, and on the other hand, how to deal with what has been not really lost, because we know exactly where it is, but what has been taken away, which originally belongs to us, but of which others have made their own property. So that today, if we want to see ourselves, we have to see ourselves courtesy of those who took something out of us. On knowledge banks and deep archive, it's an idea I'm still working with. I cannot pretend here that I have a systematic understanding of it, but my intuition is that if we are to produce something that could be called a planetary library or a planetary archive, an archive that would belong to all, that would no longer belong only to one culture, one race, one country, one nationality. If we are to move towards the idea that human productions, those works of human societies that speak deeply to our condition on Earth, because the Earth is the only space we have in common and which we have to share. If we had to move to the idea that what was done in Mapungubwe in South Africa or in Zimbabwe or in Timbuktu belongs not only to Africans but to the world at large, and what was done in China belongs not only to the Chinese but to the world at large, then we have to think precisely in planetary terms. And in any case, we don't have the choice. We don't have the choice. We can no longer think in terms of distinctive nation states with boundaries, with walls, all those things we see re-emerging with force almost everywhere. We can no longer think in those terms because we are now more than ever before conscious of the fact that the world we inhabit is limited. It is not indefinitely extensible. It is limited in its resources, in its capacities to sustain human life. And therefore, because it is limited, for the sake of our own survival, we have to recalibrate the way we humans transact with other species. So what I mean by all of that is that we are entering a new period, willingly or not, which is planetary. Our condition is nowadays planetary. It's not German, it's not French, it's not South African, it is planetary. Unfortunately, of course, we are acting in a different manner. We want to reinstate the borders, want to do all of that. It's totally counterproductive as far as I can see. That being the case, then we have to be able to imagine different kinds of institutions that are premised not on the idea of debt, a kind of debt that is expropriatory, but a kind of debt that institutes a relationship. We have to think in terms of what it is that we owe to each other. If we really don't owe anything to each other, then look, it's very clear that we are moving towards the very possibility of our extinction. Now, if our condition is planetary, I think it changes somewhat the calculus in relation to what do we do with objects that were taken away that are in Western museums for most societies in the world, and how do we make sure that those objects are not simply by default Western objects? How do we put them at the disposition of humanity in general? It seems it means not simply repatriation. Repatriation can be a serious cause to defend under certain circumstances. But it's not the only solution. Repatriation is not the only solution. I think there are many different forms of reparation and sharing that, for instance, force us to rethink the museum, for instance. We know in Germany they are building this big museum where they will put together all the art taken away from Africa, Oceania, and all those so-called primitive places. This shouldn't be a German institution. This should be a world institution. It might be located in Germany, but the technologies we have today should allow for sharing of the resources located in that institution. Unfortunately, that's not where we are. We're still thinking in terms of nation states. And whenever we think in terms of nation states, we think in terms of people who look alike, because that's the principle of the nation state. So what I'm suggesting is to move beyond the paradigm of the nation state and the kind of democracy that was built on the premise of the nation state, because it's a democracy of those who look alike. We have to move towards a democracy of the meritable, of the common, where difference does no longer matter.
So, thank you very much. We'll take two questions.
Thank you. Earlier you said that the future of humanity and the future of Africa is entwined and inseparable. Might also Africa hold the key to humanity's survival? In the sense of traditional African political philosophy, there is the image of the two-headed alligator. It means that one mouth eats, but the other one is also fed. So that means what is good for you is good for me. What is good for all of us is good for all of us. And this principle governs all of the egalitarian, large-scale sharing communities which existed in Africa for so long, for thousands and thousands of years. They're laterally connected, completely equal without centralized power, without hierarchy. And these political systems are inextricably entwined with the spiritual systems of traditional Africa society. So can you speak a little bit about the connection between the spiritual system, the magic, and this form of primitive communism? That's what Marx called it, but it's not primitive at all. It's very advanced. And this is what will save all of us, I think. So just the connection between the spiritual systems and traditional African political philosophy.
I think that your question is fantastic. It speaks directly to the idea of the deep archive I was referring to. Because if you allow me to be somewhat flippant or provocative, I really believe that the Western cycle has come to an end. That if we want to think about the major questions we'll be facing in the 21st century and the centuries that are to come, it seems to me that the Western archive is becoming thinner and thinner. We have to look into other archives. If we are to, for instance, imagine an entirely different world, a world of multiplicity. I have been reading over the last 2 weeks, I've been going back, for instance, to histories of long-distance trade in Africa. The things I have been finding are extraordinary, in the sense that, for instance, these were commercial societies which were not capitalist. That you can have a society that is based on exchange, on that valorizes wealth making, but it's not capitalist. I have discovered, but of course we all knew about this, many different forms of political systems. Societies where you could be a slave, but at the same time you could be the general of the army of that nation, where statuses, social status, was very fluid. It was never built around the type of hydraulic hierarchies we find in feudal Europe, for instance, where inequality is tolerated and yet exclusion is not. Societies where, of course, discipline exists, but you do not have institutions such as prisons. And I mentioned prisons, especially in reference to what is going on in the United States, but not only in the US, I guess almost everywhere, but in the US in particular, where black people moved from the plantation to the prison, with kind of mass incarceration logics that have been nowadays deeply embedded with the logics of profit making. So it seems to me that if we take seriously this concept of the deep archive, then Africa becomes absolutely crucial for the survival of the human species on Earth. I don't even go into the ways in which, in the continent, polities were invented that knew how to balance the requirements of human subsistence or existence and the requirements, the obligations of the existence of other species. That calculus between human well-being and the well-being of the universe at large. The taking care of the universe at large. So that philosophy of care, it seems to me, can be the cornerstone of new imaginations of a world that has, to a large extent, run out of alternatives. And I thank you for your question, but this is the work that we still have to do. And when I say we, I do not only mean academics, I also mean all of those who are invested in one way or the other in developing different multiple forms of intelligence and of redistribution of that intelligence for the benefit of all.
Thank you very much for your incredibly insightful words. If the deep archive is indeed a resource, perhaps one may look at it as a bank, I wonder if you have some cautionary notes with regards to the rampant possible abuse of the deep archive.
Sure. I thought you were happy. Are you sure? I didn't hear it.
I think Jean-Ulrich Dessert's question was, you have some notes on the abuse of the deep archive. The possible abuse of the deep archive.
Okay, you have to repeat the question.
Okay.
We as humans are a treacherous, charlatan species, and I believe that we have dipped into the archive for centuries, and there have been moments in which that deep archive can be abused by charlatans. If we look at the way in which this bank, as you might call it, has been used by the neoliberals who you brought up, then in the future, in the near future, in the future that we discuss, there is this possibility of abuse if, in fact, the archive is a resource. If we are no longer digging into the earth, but we are digging into knowledge, how can that be possibly abused? So what kind of cautionary notes might you offer around this thesis?
Okay. I'm sorry, your voice was broken. A few words. So if I'm shooting wide, you will excuse me for that. First of all, we have to use some words. The idea of knowledge banks, of course, it brings us back to the same old tropes which we are trying to get away from. But by bank, I really didn't mean the capitalist institution we know of, which is causing so much harm to almost everyone, in any case, 80% of the world population, with debts and expropriations and all that we know. So maybe I will be cautious to push forward the concept of knowledge banks. What I meant by bank is, in fact, something entirely different. It's the putting together of things, of knowledges, of resources that from then on equally belong to all. So I was using the concept of bank, or if you want, anti-banks, in that sense, in the sense of how it is that we can rehabilitate, repurpose, so to say, the idea of the public and of the common in this age of hyper-privatization. What are those things, those capacities, those forms of patrimony that have to be saved from the tragedy of privatization, of property rights, of copyrights, of all those mechanisms that aim at expropriating the many in order for the few to make profits out of that which they were not alone to contribute in the making. So it seems to me that we could complicate that concept of knowledge banks and deep archive in the direction of a rehabilitation of the idea of the public domain, and of the common, of that which, because it equally belongs to all, has to be shared. Otherwise, look, I didn't probably hear the rest of the question, so you will excuse me if I were to stop here.
Thank you very much, Achille. It's been a pleasure having you here. Thanks for sharing your thoughts with us. We're looking very much forward to having you in Berlin as soon as possible. And this time around, we'll do everything to get you.
You have to come here.
Oh, we will get there.
Bring them all to Johannesburg.
We'll bring them all to Johannesburg, one way or the other.
Everybody, we'll have you. Everybody.
Very good. Thank you so much, and have a good evening.
Thanks a lot. Thank you.
Take care.
Good luck.
Bye-bye.